artificial intelligence is everywhere right now, in your phone, in your car, even writing emails for you. You may be wondering if there are actually any limits to what AI can do. I've heard many people over the last few decades confidently assert AI can do certain things, but it's never going to be able to do, and then you fill in the blank. Guess what most of those predictions have in common? They were wrong. The past few years have shown exponential growth in AI capabilities, bringing it from the research lab to everyday life. And it's doing most of those things that so many thought it never would or even could do. Of course, many limitations still exist, but my advice would be this: don't bet against AI. Unless, of course, you want to be wrong. In this video, we're going to start with a look at what knowledge really is, how it differs from data and information, and this will help set the context. Then we'll take a look at what have been considered to be the limits of AI, and see which ones of those things have actually been accomplished and what's still left to do. Then we'll conclude with some ideas about the role of AI and humans and where each one excels, with the hope of learning how to use this amazing technology to our best advantage. Let's start off with looking at the relationship that exists among data, information, knowledge, and wisdom. And we'll use this pyramid to spell it out. So we'll start with data. Okay, this is just basically raw facts. If I give you data that looks like this, I say 10, 6, 42, and 8. Okay, that's raw facts. So what? You don't know really what to do with that, but that's data for you. Okay, now if I add some context to this data, now we have information. So this is where we've sort of processed it a little more. And now I'm going to tell you that this data actually represents the ages of people in a room. So now we have more context. This has more meaning to us. Now, if I take that and say, okay, but let's apply some interpretation to the information that we just had, now we end up with knowledge. Now, knowledge tells us yet more. So for instance, in this case, we might say, okay, I've observed that most of the people in this room are under the age of 21. So now we've done yet more processing with this. And now finally, the last piece of this is applied knowledge. Applied knowledge now gives us wisdom. And wisdom might look at this, all of this information, all of this data, all of this knowledge, and say, you know what, we've got these people in a room, let's do something like do age-appropriate games to keep them occupied. So the 42-year-old probably won't mind too much playing a game that a 10-year-old and an 8-year-old would play, but you know they can go along with that for a little while. So this is an example, very trivial example, but you can see what I've done here. Data, information, knowledge, and wisdom. Each one of these adds more context, more interpretation, and all of these then lead to the ultimate of wisdom. So another way to look at this pyramid is data. Well, that's a database, for instance. You know, we can store a lot of stuff in there, but that's all it is, just a collection of raw facts. Information, okay, we have an application running on a computer. That's now information technology. That's why we call it that. We've added context to all of that data. Knowledge, this is where AI really starts to come in. Now we're adding more interpretation to the information that we've just processed. But here is where we're still trying to get, and that's wisdom. Back when I was an undergrad riding my dinosaur to class and studying AI in its earliest days, there were a lot of things that people said, these are the limits of AI. Maybe one day we'll have a system that's able to do these, but they won't be anywhere, maybe even in our lifetimes. For instance, one of the things that was talked about was the ability to reason. We needed a system, if we really consider it intelligence, then reasoning is a part of that. So the ability to figure out and do problem solving, complex problem solving, this was beyond our capability, certainly in those days. But since then, we've come out with a computer that can play chess. IBM in 1997 came out with a computer called Deep Blue that played Garry Kasparov, the best chess player in the world, a grandmaster. That's a lot of reasoning. That's a lot of problem solving. People thought you'd never have a computer that would be able to beat a grandmaster. Again, that's already happened. So what seemed to be a limitation wasn't. Another one that was really difficult for a long time was natural language processing. Our human language has a lot of nuance, a lot of idioms, things where we say things that we don't mean literally, and sometimes you're supposed to interpret it literally, sometimes it is figurative speech. For instance, as I've given examples before, if we say it's raining cats and dogs, we know that it doesn't mean that there are small animals falling out of the sky. That's an idiom. So we have, if a system is going to really be intelligent in the way that we are, it needs to be able to understand those things. It needs to be able to understand things like humor and understand when you're cracking a joke and when you're not. Well, sometimes people can't tell that either, and sometimes it's because it's a bad dad joke. But be that as it may, in general, we're able to tell the difference between what is humor and what is not. And we've actually made some advancements here. In 1965, there came out the first of what really is the modern chatbots, but this was not using modern technology, called Eliza. And it was able to have conversations with you. Now, it wasn't very great conversations, but it would ask you questions and answer questions. How are you feeling today? How does that make you feel? This kind of thing, almost like you feel like you're talking to one of these very passive psychologists. But IBM advanced this a lot in 2011 when we came out with Watson, which played Jeopardy, the TV game show, and was able to win and beat champions at that, because Jeopardy is full of natural language and play on words, puns, and things like that. You can't program all of those into the system and have it know those. It really has to understand the meanings behind those things in order to do it. And in fact, as I say, we've already accomplished that. And look at today's modern chatbots. They're able to understand a lot of this nuance, and they're able to take the instructions you give it in natural language and understand what you mean in a surprising way. In fact, I think that's maybe one of the most remarkable aspects of generative AI technology, is that it's able to do that. For the first time, we feel like a computer really understands us. It's able to infer what we're asking for, in some cases even anticipate the next thing that we need, just like a person would. We would consider that to be intelligent. How about creativity? The ability to create. I remember hearing a lot of people say, you know, computers can't really create information. Well, they actually do. We've got where, with generative AI, we can create art, we can create new works of music, and you can say, well, but those are really just mashups of existing. Well, guess what? When people compose a new song or draw a new picture, we're influenced by the things that we've heard as well. Listen to all the top musical artists that you know, and they'll tell you, oh yeah, here are my musical influences. So those things all went into the back of their heads and influenced the way that they create. So we are creating new things, and they are variations on the old. But that doesn't mean just because a computer did it, it wasn't creative, because in fact it is. They're coming up with new ideas and will continue to do that. We base our learning and our creativity on certain things that have been done in the past, and so does AI. Now here's another one, real-time perception. Things like robots. Well, that was the stuff of science fiction at one point, but we have them today. And you might not think of it as a robot, but a self-driving car is one of those, where it's having to, in real time, perceive its environment, see what's going on, anticipate where the next car is going to move, and where it's going to be at a specific point in time, and do all of those calculations in real time, and make real decisions about that. Robots are having to do the same thing in order to navigate around a room. So all of these things that basically we used to consider to be limits of AI, I'm gonna say, you know what, we've done all of those. Now, let's take a look at some other areas where we've made progress, but I don't know if we would say, you know, it's sort of mission accomplished yet. And one of those would be the area of, you've heard of an IQ, how about an EQ, an emotional intelligence, and an index for that. Well, these systems are able to simulate that, and honestly, I feel like some people are just able to simulate emotional intelligence as well, but that's a whole other subject. But an EQ in a system, you can see in the modern chatbots the ability for them to understand your moods and the way that you're expressing yourself. So there is some level of awareness in terms of the way that you're describing things. I mean, we have the stories about people who felt an emotional relationship to a chatbot. Well, some people feel an emotional relationship to their shoe, but that's a whole other thing. The fact that these systems can talk to us and understand, at least give the appearance of understanding moods and things like that, is certainly in the area of, okay, it looks like we're doing this, at least in some cases. Now, another area that's a limitation, though, that we still have is this area of hallucinations. Hallucinations are a difficult problem. They're a byproduct of generative AI, where the system basically confidently asserts something that just isn't true. So it's trying to predict what the right answer would be, and many, many times it's right. It's shockingly right. But when it's wrong, it is shockingly wrong in these cases. Now, we've got technologies that are making hallucinations less and less likely. Things like retrieval, augmented generation, helps with this, where we feed additional information to give more context so that the model doesn't just use its own imagination to come up with answers. Things like mixture of experts helps as well, where we have different models used for different areas, chaining of models. So there are things that we can do in order to reduce the hallucination problem, and we're doing that. So this is one of those, I wouldn't say is a solved problem, but we can certainly see that we're moving into it. So this one's somewhat solved. Okay, so those are the things that we've kind of already done or are still working on and maybe be able to see an end in sight. Let's move those out of the way. And now let's take a look at the future. In other words, what are the current limits? What are the problems that we're still having to work on these days? Well, one of the limits of AI is a thing called artificial general intelligence. Right now, we see AIs that are super smart in a specific area, in a specific knowledge area. Now, again, with some of these chatbots that we have today, they seem to know a lot about pretty much everything, but they also have limitations. For instance, they don't do real-time perception. They can't tie their own shoes, for instance. So artificial general intelligence would be something that was as smart as a person, doing all the things that we consider to be intelligent, and at least on par with what a person would do across all the different domains. That's something that we haven't really fully achieved in a single system yet. The next level beyond that would be artificial superintelligence, where we have something that is better than humans in every domain. And that's the right now, again, the stuff of science fiction. Not saying that we won't do it, but we haven't really done it yet. Another problem that's still to be solved is with sustainability. So right now, we have systems that can do amazing stuff, but boy, do they suck up the gas. They take up all the electricity, they need lots of cooling, they're very expensive to run. This is not something that's going to be able to scale. If we just keep throwing more and more processors at this situation, that's not going to work. We're going to end up using all the electricity that's on the planet just in order to run some of these queries. So we're going to have to be able to make better, smarter decisions with sustainability, use models that are the right size, not just the biggest model, but the right size model. In some cases, a small model might be more efficient and do a better job and might even hallucinate less if we've got the right use case. So this is still work that we're doing that is not yet, I would say, a solved problem, but there's a lot of things we can do about it. Another one that is really the area that is science fiction today is self-awareness. So is a system self-aware? Does it know it exists? Does it have consciousness? Well, I don't really know the answer to that. This is really not a computer science question. This is a philosophy question. So I'm not going to try to deal with that one here because I'm not even sure how the answer would be. But another thing that gets us back into this area, though, is understanding. So a system can spit out a lot of things, but does it actually understand what it's saying? Does it really know what the meaning of the things are? Seems like it's done a lot of that, but there's always the question of, is this really just simulating? Is it simulating thought? Well, I don't know. I'll tell you, there's a lot of people I've talked to, and I think they may be only simulating thought and simulating intelligence. So again, it's a little hard to draw the line clearly, but this seems to be a limitation where the AI maybe doesn't understand the biggest, broadest context that we'd like it to understand. Judgment. So remember when I was talking about data, information, knowledge, and wisdom, well, this is that last one. This is the business of wisdom and judgment. And in this case, is the system able to make good judgments, maybe ethical judgments? Can it determine what is right and what's wrong? Again, can people do that? Some people have a real hard problem with those kind of judgments, so it's hard for us to program a system that will if we can't figure out what those rules would be. But we certainly know that right now these are limitations that the systems have. How about in terms of judging something that's just very subjective, like the quality of something, maybe music? You know, what I think is really great music, you may not think. So, you know, you say, well, Jeff, you have no judgment at all. But I have a different view of that. But these systems, are they able to, they're able to generate music and they're able to throw away stuff that is just absolute gibberish, but can they tell what is going to be a hit and what's not going to be, for instance, in the music area? So there's a lot of work here in this space so that it's able to do some of those qualitative judgments as well. How about this one? Common sense. And I'm going to really put that one in quotes, because air quotes, because I mean, is it really all that common? It seems like, again, we have limitations with people, so we can't really expect a system to be able to perfectly do what we consider to be common sense, because we all might have a different idea about that. Certainly there are some things that we know, and the systems ought to be able to understand that. But today, there are certainly some limitations to that. How about in terms of goal setting? Well, some people would say that with today's agentic AI, that a system can in fact set its own goals and go off and accomplish those things. And what I'm going to make a distinction here is that we have micro goals. These are sort of the small things that we need to do if I give you a larger task, and the macro goals. So the larger task, this is what needs to be done. This is how I go about doing it. And right now, today's agents are able to do these kind of micro goals, the goals within the larger objective. But the big goal, why would we do this in the first place? That's maybe still beyond its reach at the moment. And then sensation. How about this? Does an AI system really sense things? Does it understand what's happening, how things feel, how things taste? That sort of stuff. The things that are of the senses. Well, we're building robots that are able to certainly see and hear. Can they taste? In some cases, maybe to an extent. But there's a lot of other things that go into these kinds of sensations that we haven't put all together in one system. And then here's the really big one, I think, and that's deep emotions. Is a system really able to feel the same way that we do? Is it able to experience joy? Is it able to experience sadness, loss, accomplishment? Does it really get what all that's about? And again, I know some people who don't really do all that particularly well. So this is one of the things that is difficult to put into a system. And we can simulate it today, but is it really feeling these kinds of things? So I would suggest to you, these are some of the things that, to one degree or another, are limitations with today's AI. Now, what is the role for humans and for AI? How do we work together? How do we make sure this is a tool that works for us? Well, people really should be over here doing this kind of stuff. Answering the what question. What is it we want to do? That's the overall macro level goal, the objective. And answering the question, why? What's the purpose of this? Is there meaning in what we're doing? What's the ultimate thing that we're trying to accomplish? And without purpose, all of this is just meaningless work. So people are still far better at that kind of thing, and we should be the ones controlling this tool that way. Over here on this side, once we've told the system what needs to be done, AI can, in many cases, with an agent, figure out the how and go off and perform it, actually do it. Agents are able to automate a lot of things much faster than a person could, and they can do it in an optimized way. But they need to know what to do in the first place. We need to know why. So if you look at a history of AI, it felt like for the longest time, we were making very little progress, and then all of a sudden, it just took off. And we're at this inflection point where the developments and where all of this is going to go, no one really knows. But what I can say this for sure, we can look at a history of milestones that we've accomplished already, and we can look at lots of future research, things that still need to be done, which is actually very exciting. If you're someone that enjoys IT and the possibilities of problem solving, then we're going to be able to do a lot more work. And ultimately, we're going to end up with systems that do things we didn't even imagine yet. So my advice to you, if you start looking at the limitations of AI today, I would say don't become preoccupied with those. Because the people who have and have asserted that AI will never do this, that, or the other thing have generally been wrong. My advice to you, don't bet against AI.